Thank you for tuning in to Cop with Comic. I'm Brian Kopp, and we're here with comic Kate Hester. Kate Hester, how the hell are
you? I'm good. Thank you so much for having me, Brian.
Well, thank you, because you are fresh on the heels of a big old victory or top, you know, podium finish at the New Jersey Comedy Festival.
Yeah, that was really exciting. I was very pleased with that whole situation.
I was pleased with myself. I did about as well as I could have.
Yeah, you know, I was really nervous, and it all seemed to work out in the end. So I was happy about that.
And so how did that work? Because I think each night had an industry pick and an audience pick. Mm-hmm. And then is that because a set of comics would have their own audience? So it was only fair in that respect to crown an industry pick and an audience pick. And what was the difference between them, et cetera?
Well, that I'm not 100% sure how they
I
set
did
it
good,
up
but
like
I don't
that.
Know how they did it. Yeah.
No. I mean, I don't know why they did it that way. I guess they just wanted to give more people an opportunity to move forward, you know, to make it a little more exciting, you know, and that way, I think you get a range of comics, like from, you know, like I'm not exactly like super pro level yet. I'm still kind of new. So the audience pick gives, you know, it gave me, I got the audience pick for the Jersey Strong Showcase. So that gave me the opportunity to move into the final round.
Oh, good. And then so you performed once to get that first award, but then you guys all moved on and you all performed before the same audience, and that's how you got crowned third place?
Well, no, it was a different audience. It was a different night. I mean, maybe there were some of the same people in the audience, but...
Yeah, different audience, different night, but like the winners from each night were then performing again, so then it was fair to measure you guys against each other.
Yes.
Because on your first night doing it, you weren't against, like I had former guests Lily Lester and Christiana Jackson on, and I think they... won one of those picks on their night, but then everybody, so you actually didn't do comedy with Lily Lester and Christiana Jackson on their first night, right?
No, I was in the Jersey Strong Showcase, and they were in different showcases,
but then you guys all advanced to this another round, and then all you winners kind of went before the same audience as each other.
Yes.
Okay, and then they were able to crown the winner because it's equal that way. You guys are all in the same audience.
Yeah, I guess you could say that, yeah.
Okay, and so, you got third place. I think Christiana Jackson got first or second, I think.
Yeah, well, she won. She won the thing. There wasn't really like a first place, second place, or third place. Okay. There was like a top three and then the winner of the top three.
And then they're like, you got to fight each other for second place, but you have to do it on your own time.
Yeah.
The theater's closed.
Yeah. We have to have like an over the top style arm wrestling competition, I think. But I think it was a guy, so I don't know if I'm going to win that arm wrestling competition or not.
And it doesn't have the feat of strength just has to be hilarious. It doesn't really matter who wins. Yeah. Whoever's funnier in the fucking situation.
Yeah.
So, and it looks like you're doing like all these shows in New York City. I see you're doing a show with Carly Montag and who was the other one I saw? Yeah, so some former guests. I mean, so you're just rocking and rolling with the rooftop shows, park shows, Zoom shows. What have you been doing?
I'm mostly getting Zoom shows right now, but I'm doing my best to get the rooftop and park shows. You know, they're hard. It's like 1,000 comedians scrambling for these shows, like the last helicopter leaving the island. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I had Jake Velasquez on earlier tonight, and he does Penthouse Comedy. And of course they do Tiny Cupboard, which is one of the rooftop venues, I guess. But then I think he also has his own rooftop. So if you really want to get a rooftop show, just you know, buy a building with a rooftop, right?
Yeah.
It's that
I will.
Easy, right? It's that cheap and easy, right?
Yep, there you go.
But you probably could, because you're a successful artist. You do tape art, which is fucking cool. Like I look so on Twitter, your personal comedy account or just general account is Kate Hester, K-A-Y-T. And then on Instagram, you're Kate Balls of Fire, which is hilarious. There's a numeral in there. But you also do Kate_tape for your tape art. And, mm-hmm. and you're pretty successful with this tape art. I mean, you did a Pixie show. You did their big Caribou backing, which is super cool because they have Caribou the song.
Yes, I was very lucky to have been asked to do artwork for their 30th anniversary Surfer Rosa tour. And I know I'm a huge Pixies fan. How that happened was It was about 9 years ago. I did an art show where all the pieces were based on Pixie songs. And I got a big write-up in a magazine because of that art show. And then their social media guy, I guess he had a Google filter set up for Pixies tribute. So he got an email about it. And then I got this phone call because he called the art gallery and was like, I work for the Pixies. I'm looking to get in touch with Kate Hester. So they were like, here's her phone number. So yeah. So I'm at home doing my hair, getting ready for the art show. And I get this phone call and they're like, hey, I work for the Pixies. And they saw this article and they want to meet you and they want to invite you out and to come see them and meet them. And I was like, is this a fucking prank? I was like, no. I was like, yeah, I don't think so, buddy. And he was like, no, I'm dead serious. I'll email you all the information. And then I just started screaming, I think. So that was 10 years ago. Luckily, I kept my cool. And we've all remained friends. And they reach out to me like when they need little things done. And that's like a huge privilege. So
that's cool, because it would seem to be, I mean, it's probably difficult as hell, but it could be cost effective compared to other backdrops, because I see this Ed is Dead backdrop. You did that one, too?
Yes, I did all their lyrics. Like, I spent like a whole month taping out by hand all these lyrics, and then their art and design guy picked and chose which one he wanted.
Okay, wow. Yes, yeah, so I suppose it is pretty labor intensive, though.
Yeah, it's very labor intensive. That's why I'm kind of easing back off of the artwork a little bit to focus more on comedy.
Because it's so labor intensive?
Well, it is, you know, it's burning me out a little bit. It's been 15, 17 years, something like that, of me hunched over a little table, ripping pieces of masking tape into tiny bits. Like, my neck hurts, my arms hurt. I'm a little burnt out on it. So,
yeah, well, we'll get away from it in 1 second after we go into the Kate Moss thing, because it sounds like you're as big of a Kate Moss fan as I am.
I am. She just has an extraordinary face for recreating in black masking tape. And, you know, I just
why
think
is
she's
that?
So...
Because I mean, you did the big ad from when she started, where she's playing with she's picking at her toes or whatever. Like, you did that in tape art. And I love that. That whole campaign and the whole earlier Sorrenti stuff was amazing, because she was just so waifish. But she turned out to be one of the better models in the history of time, because she can be chameleon-like. But you're saying that she's good for masking tape. And is part of that the fact that the famous ads were in black and white?
Yeah, you know, they were just so simple and streamlined and black and white, and her face is just so perfectly symmetrical. It's almost like not of this earth. But I could start sounding like a big weirdo when I talk about Kate Moss real fast.
Me too. Yeah, so I started with my law school loans, I actually started a modeling roster. And one of like the biggest models I wanted, just, you know, the girl in the neighborhood, she was a barista, but she was thinner than Kate. And she had that perfectly symmetrical wide face. And after that, I was like, all right, I'm done. I've hung it up. It's just like after I talk with Kate Hester, it's like, all right, I've done everything I need to with Gotham with comedy.
Yeah, there we go.
So with comedy, it's like, you know, I think you have an interesting day job that you might talk about on stage, right?
Yes, I am a pedestrian safety specialist for the state of New Jersey.
You know, everybody's always saying there is downsides to keeping everybody inside. Like, meaning because people get depressed and stuff like that. But in letting people leave their home and things like that, you're seeing the danger in that, not only with the pandemic, but you're seeing it with like traffic. Like, a lot of the traffic-related fatalities were decreasing for a second there.
No, actually, they picked up.
They picked up.
With the pandemic, people are driving like absolute maniacs. And the pedestrians are all distracted and worried and not paying attention. And that's like, my job did not, the busyness did not falter. Like,
oh shit.
Yeah.
And so is the education materials you're putting together kind of trying to address the fact that, hey, we know you're distracted with awful shit.
Yeah.
You need to look up every once in a while.
Plus, it's like every like Tom, Dick, and Harry guy that's been in an office job for the past 30 years has finally got 3 months off of work. And he's like, you know what? I'm going to buy a bike, even though I haven't been on a bike since I was 20 years old. And they're on these bikes and they're just driving out into traffic. Yeah, it was like a ton of bike incidents. Everyone was getting hit by cars during the pandemic. It was fucking ridiculous. And you know who gets hit by cars the most? are adult men. Yeah, I think that statistic is hilarious.
Yeah, it's because like, we're just so oblivious.
Guys. Yeah, yeah. Or it's like you guys are supposed to be better at everything than the rest of us. Yet you can't look both ways before crossing the goddamn street.
Not better at walking, yeah. Are you guys?
Yeah, exactly. Not better pedestrians, chauvinist. You know.
You guys are getting yours. You guys think you own the fucking right of way, and you're getting hit as a result.
Yeah, exactly. You know, anyway, go on. I'm sorry.
I love that. Yeah, if you're too cool to fucking look both ways, what else are you too cool to do? And is that kind of, you know, is that kind of. We have to give guys walking helmets now.
Yeah.
Is that stuff making us way interact, like the relationship stuff, the difference between men and women, or not really?
I think it certainly says something. There's definitely something there in that statistic. The fact that adult men are getting hit by cars more than any other human being. Like, why?
Yeah.
Why is that? Yeah, more than kids. Yeah. Why? Like, what makes you guys think you could, like, what, go up against a car? Like, you can't. It's still bigger than you. It's still heavier than you are.
Yeah,
that's
a way to kind of ridicule the world, but also ridicule like any male characters in your life. Like, have you had bosses in the past that you've been able, like, since you've had so many jobs, is that a good thing for comedy because you're able to kind of, you know, make fun of people or archetypes that you've kind of run across along the way, like composite characters of shitty bosses past?
Absolutely, most of my set is me talking about like past bosses and jobs. You know, because it's real. A, it's real. And B, it's like, it's, you know, when you work a bunch of jobs in Jersey City, New Jersey, you're going to have stories, you know.
So. Yeah, what's it like? Yeah, how can you, you know, for somebody, I think I've been there accidentally once. And so how do you compare and contrast like Jersey City versus New York City?
Well, Jersey City is got every economic level, and it's one of the most culturally diverse cities in the world, actually. Okay. And it's like you've got those of us who are working three jobs to pay the rent, and then you've got the people who mommy and daddy are paying the rent while they're writing their screenplay, you know, and then you've got like the people who are like raising their brothers and sisters. So you've got everybody. We're all in it together, you know.
Yeah.
And for the most part, we all do want to get along. Like, I love all my neighbors. I've formed really meaningful relationships with, like, with people from every place, you know?
And so, I mean, like, what was their experience with Black Lives Matter protests?
We had many, and I went to as many as I could. Okay. There was no bad incidents. Everything went as smoothly as possible. And, you know, Jersey City's a great place to live. I really love it here. And I do want to live here for the rest of my life.
Good. And so, I mean, is it pretty easy to kind of get in for spots, like even if the spots are far away, like Brooklyn?
You mean like comedy wise?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, right now it's very difficult to get any type of spots in Brooklyn because first of all, it's three train rides away for me.
Yeah.
And it's like, I'm still like, okay, well, there's still a pandemic. Do I really want to spend an hour on a train?
Yeah.
On three trains.
Yeah, yeah. It's fucking airborne.
And like standing on train platforms and waiting. It's going to take me like an hour and a half to get to some spot in the park, you know? But
like, let me hop on a Zoom show. I can get on a couple Zoom shows in that time.
Yeah, I can. I do have way more Zoom shows right now. I've got one live show lined up in the Bronx, I think for the first or second week in September that I'm looking forward to. Yeah, that'll be fun. That's with the Concourse Comedy guys who've been really sweet to me since I started. And Jersey City comedy scene is very clicky. It's a lot of dudes booking the same guys over and over and over again. But they're nice guys, so I'm just waiting for them to reach out to me, which I'm hoping will be sooner or later. You know, they know I'm here. They know where to find me. you know,
You could just ask, yeah. You know, it's like, I mean, I suppose the Pixies called you up back in the day because they heard about Kate Hester's tape art. And maybe that'll be the case now that you rocked and rolled in the New Jersey Comedy Festival. But sometimes you can just probably ask and they'd be like, hell yeah, you just won that fucking competition. That's a credit. Yeah. That's a credit now for our flyer.
Yeah, I am very happy I finally have a credit, you know.
Yeah. So, you got credit, and then you got copping with comic, you know?
I know. I'm just racking them up. It's been a good week. I am still new. I'm just entered my second year, so.
Wow, you're doing pretty good for year two, right? Not a bad year.
Yeah, I'm in my first year anniversary just passed. It was actually the day of the Jersey City Comedy Festival was my first anniversary, I know.
All you should have been like, what's up, chumps? This is my 1 year anniversary of comedy. And they'll be like, dude, I've been doing it for 5 years to get to this point.
Yeah, I know. I try not to, actually, here I am talking about it with you, but I try not to bring that up so much because people will automatically dismiss you.
Yeah.
Whether once they find out that you've been in it for just a year, it's like, oh, you know, she's too green. I don't want anything to do with her. When it's like, no, I actually had a really good year. I've worked my ass off. You know, like, I'm in this to win it. I'm not just some asshole that gets up there and is like, so, Tinder, am I right? You know what I mean?
Yeah, you're not a dilettante. And I think there's people similarly situated, you know, where they're starting out, but they're fucking hustling their ass off. And those are the people you see at all the mics and you see on all the shows. And really, like, if you're down to earth and just a cool person to hang with and you got some good chops, and it sounds like you do, I really think you're going to find those people similarly situated.
Yeah, I'm trying it, and I've been lucky. I've had a lot of really nice people give me a chance, and for that, I'm very grateful. Yeah.
Good, and she's going to give back, just like she does as a successful artist. Like, if there's artists below you on the rung, you pull them up.
Yeah, definitely. If anything I've learned this year is to be nice to the newbies, you know?
Yes, because like, really? The world is small. The world is small. If you act like a bee, if you act like a bee, it's going to spread pretty quick.
They'll or be like, it's hey. Like, yeah. It's like, you know, I get it. You don't want to throw a great show at me because you didn't get a great show in your first year.
Yeah.
I get that. And there's like a chain of command and a list of rules. But it's like, but you know what? Nobody knows who the fuck you are either. So
and I,
get
yeah,
over
and
yourself. Yeah.
And Ariel Dundas said something like, there's enough gatekeepers where if you piss off one gatekeeper, there's a hundred more in New York City. You know, it's
that's
not like
true.
I think she started in Amsterdam where there was exactly one gatekeeper.
Yeah, that's
and so,
true.
Yeah,
and
but really,
I love her too. She's great.
Oh yeah, she's so funny, and so is Kate Hester. She's really, I mean, Kate Moss used to be meaningful to me, but the only Kate I care about is Kate Hester.
Oh, stop.
But she's Kate Hester, KAYT Hester at Twitter, and also Kate Balls of Fire on Instagram. Kate Hester, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate your time.